Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. Two important announcements about Phoenix Initiative course and about 2020 prelims test series. The Phoenix Initiative course consists of 4 modules along with free access to 18 tests. This course along with prelims test series will be helpful to revise the syllabus effectively for the upcoming 2020 prelims exam. Dear aspirants, note that the admissions are open till 4th October 2020 and for more information, visit the registration link given in the description of this video and also given in the comment section. Now let's proceed to the analysis. These are the list of news articles taken for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. Now let's move on to the analysis of first news article. This discussion is based on this advertisement of Southern Western Railway about the first roll-on roll-off service train from Karnataka to Maharashtra, particularly between Nelamangala near Bengaluru in Karnataka and Bale near Solapur in Maharashtra. So today we'll see what is this roll-on roll-off service train and what are its benefits. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, RORO stands for roll-on roll-off. A roll-on roll-off train does not have bogies or wagons like the normal trains we know. In Indian slang, bogie is a railway carriage like a passenger coach as you see in this picture. Wagon refers to a railway freight vehicle as shown in these pictures. So what does a roll-on roll-off train have? See, it has long metal platform in the place of bogies or wagons. And the roll-on roll-off train pulls this long metal platform on which lorries or trucks with goods are loaded. The driver and cleaner of the truck travel along being in their truck cabin and they are dropped at a particular point. Now in this arrangement, trucks are loaded through a ramp provided at the dead end of a loop on BRN wagons. Now this picture shows a bogie air brake flat wagon or BRN wagon. These wagons are suitably modified for through passage of trucks over them. See, in these wagons, the top side is empty so that trucks or other road transport vehicles can also be loaded. Now, before loading over the wagons, the trucks are weighed and passed under a height gauge to ensure that they conform to the maximum moving dimensions for safe passage. Here, note that even other road vehicles can be transported. So, in short, roll-on roll-off service carries road vehicles on rail transport. So the roll-on roll-off is a delivery model which can provide multimodal transport mix. It provides a unique road-rail synergy. So from the above discussion, we can also call it as trucks on train system. Now this roll-on roll-off service was introduced by Indian Railways in the period 1998-1999. It was introduced on Konkan Railway when the Konkan Railway Corporation did not have enough freight traffic. Now let us see the benefits of this roll-on roll-off service or system. First, it is a convenient, hassle-free system for the movement of trucks. Second, it is economical because it saves fuel and also saves time. Time is saved because the speed of roll-on roll-off train is fast enough as compared to the movement by road. Therefore, it ensures faster transport of essential goods, perishables, food items and also smaller cargo as well. And the terminal time of loading or unloading is just normally 15 to 20 minutes in roll-on roll-off. So in this way, it reduces turnaround time for trucks, or in other words, it provides better turnaround of trucks. Now, turnaround refers to the process of completing a task or the time needed to complete a task. More importantly, the cost of transport is lesser than that of the transport by the road. Then there is no hassle of duties like toll duty, etc. Then there is almost no risk of accidents. So it improves safety. Then it also helps to avoid congestion on the roads. Then there is no extra paperwork. It is also an environment friendly mode of transport. This is because of the less pollution as trucks are not plying or not traveling on the roads. Now many sectors are benefited from this roll-on roll-off service trains. These sectors are agriculture, industries, chemicals, etc. These goods of these sectors can be transported. Now it brings prosperity particularly for farmers as it provides linkage between agro-producing regions and agro-consumption centers. Therefore, it also gives boost to government initiatives like Operation Greens. See, as you know, the objective of Operation Greens is to enhance the value realization of top farmers by targeted interventions to strengthen top production clusters and their farmer producer organizations, and also to link and connect the production clusters with the market. Here, when we say top, we are referring to tomato, onion, and potato. Now, Operation Greens also aims to reduce post-harvest losses through creation of farm gate infrastructure, development of suitable agro-logistics. So, it also aims to establish firm linkages with production clusters. Now, these objectives of Operation Greens are comfortably or easily achieved through the linkages provided by roll-on, roll-off service trains between agro-producing regions and agro-consumption centers. Now, because of all these benefits, the roll-on, roll-off system facilitates safer, speedier, and more reliable transport, while at the same time, it also plays a crucial role for sectors like agriculture. Now, in this COVID-19 pandemic, this service has come in handy, particularly with restrictions on movements of vehicles on road were imposed by government as part of the lockdown. And during the lockdown period, Indian Railways upscaled transportation by using roll-on, roll-off facilities so as to carry loaded trucks to ensure speedy and efficient supply of essential commodities. And now, for the same purpose, Railway Ministry has notified roll-on, roll-off service for transporting goods-laden vehicles between Karnataka and Maharashtra so as to ensure smooth flow of essential commodities. Now, the roll-on, roll-off service to be introduced between Karnataka and Maharashtra is to have a capacity of carrying 42 trucks in a single system in one trip. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news. In this analysis, we discussed about roll-on, roll-off trains. What are the various benefits of these trains? We saw the objectives of Operation Greens. We saw how roll-on, roll-off service plays a crucial role in achieving the objectives of Operation Greens. Then we saw how amidst lockdown, these trains are crucial in the movement of essential items. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article talks about the ongoing tussle between Turkey and Greece. The news states that Turkey will be conducting a military exercise in the Mediterranean Sea close to northwest Cyprus for the next 2 weeks. In this regard, we had discussed about the ongoing issue in the Mediterranean region in our 28th August news analysis. On that day, we saw in detail about the geography of Mediterranean Sea and also the countries that border the Mediterranean Sea. In today's discussion, let us concentrate on Turkey. See, Turkey is a country which is large and roughly rectangular peninsula. It lies partly in Asia and partly in Europe, and in this regard, it occupies a unique geographic strategic position, and it acts both as a barrier and also as bridge between the two continents. The European portion of Turkey is called as Thrace. It encompasses 3% of total area of Turkey, but it is important as it is home to more than 10% of the total Turkish population. Thrace is separated from Asian portion of Turkey by Bosporus Strait, then the Sea of Marmara, then Dardanelles Strait. Now, this is important from the perspective of geography. The Asian part of this country is known by a variety of names. For example, Asia Minor, Asiatic Turkey, Anatolian Plateau, Anatolia. And Turkey extends more than 1,600 kilometers from west to east, but generally less than 800 kilometers from north to south. Now, coming to the borders of Turkey, if we go clockwise, see, it is bounded by Black Sea on the north. On the northeast, if you observe, it is bordered by Georgia and Armenia. On the eastern side, it is bordered by Azerbaijan and Iran. On the southeast, it is bordered by Iraq and Syria. On the southwest, it is bounded by Mediterranean Sea. And the west of Turkey is bounded by Aegean Sea. On the northwest, if you see, we can find Greece and Bulgaria. So, and we should know that most of the islands along Aegean coast, they are part of Greece. And some of the islands of Greece are very, very close to Turkey. And it is said that only two islands in this Aegean Sea remains in Turkish hands. And the maritime boundary with Greece has been a source of dispute between Turkey and Greece. And coming to Cyprus, Cyprus is an island nation which is south of Turkey in the Mediterranean Sea. Coming to other geographical information related to Turkey, it is a predominantly mountainous country and the true lowlands are confined to the coastal fringes. Its highest mountain is Mount Ararat. And know that the Tigris-Euphrates river system, which is the great river system of southwestern Asia, they have their sources in eastern Turkey. Then they travel southeast through Syria and Iraq and drains into Persian Gulf. Now let's see briefly about Turkey's involvement in the geopolitics of the region. See, we should know that Turkey's unique geographical strategic position straddling Europe and Asia gives an increasing role as a destination country and also as a transit country for migrants and refugees so as to reach Europe. In 1997, Turkey was declared eligible to join the European Union. This was because Turkey plays a strategic role with respect to European Union on issues such as migration, security, counter-terrorism, and also in the sphere of economy. But know that it is still not yet a member of European Union, though it is a member of NATO. Now, why it is not a member of European Union? There have been concerns with respect to establishment of customs union. The reports say that there are issues yet to be settled regarding certain agreements like Ankara Association Agreement of 1963, etc. But in the current times, if you see why Turkey might not be able to join European Union, is because of going backwards in the realms of democracy, rule of law, fundamental rights, particularly in the context of secular credentials. You can relate the backsliding of secular credentials of Turkey, the recent announcements or conversions of museums into mosques. So these are some of the information with reference to Turkey that we have seen in this analysis. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. Let us take this frequently asked questions column, which is titled as "What is the new idea on supply chains?" This article tries to explain how trade supply chains are heavily dependent on international or bilateral relations. It also talks how they are affected by the pandemic scenario as well. In this context, let us have a brief discussion on India-Japan relations and how diversification of sources would build resilience and economic stability. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of this article is highlighted here for your reference. So first, let's have a brief recap of Indo-Japanese relations. See, the friendship between India and Japan has a long history that is rooted in spiritual affinity and strong cultural and civilizational ties. See, this is the opening statement given by the Ministry of External Affairs on the brief of India-Japan relations. See, India's earliest documented direct contact with Japan was with the Todaiji temple in Nara, where the consecration of Lord Buddha was performed by an Indian monk by name Bodhisena. This took place in 752 AD. Here, when we say consecration of Lord Buddha, we are referring to eye-opening of the towering statue of Lord Buddha. Now, in contemporary times, among prominent Indians associated with Japan were Swami Vivekananda, Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, J.R.D. Tata, Subhas Chandra Bose, and Judge Radha Binod Pal. There is also Japan-India Association, which was set up in 1903, and it is today the oldest international friendship body in Japan. Now, coming to this century, India and Japan relationship elevated or raised exponentially with very frequent high-profile visits between both the countries. In the year 2019 alone, that is in last year, there were as many as 7 Indian high-profile visits to Japan, ranging from President, Prime Minister to External Affairs Minister. Now, talking about trade, if you take the financial year 2017-18, India-Japan bilateral trade stood at or reached $15.71 billion. So, this is about the close relationship between two Asian democracies, India and Japan. In the recent years, India and Japan are even moving closer in the realm of security interests as well. One such example we can see both India and Japan being part of quadrilateral or Quad. Quad stands for four. It was initially conceived in the year 2007. It is an informal dialogue mechanism among four countries, which are India, Japan, United States of America, and Australia. It was also reported that Quad was the initiative made by Japan. Now, as per the news article, Japan has come up with one more initiative called as Supply Chain Resilience Initiative. So, what do we mean by supply chain resilience? See, it is an approach that helps a country to ensure that it has diversified its supply risk across a clutch of supplying nations, instead of being dependent on just one or just few countries. Simply to say, our imports or exports should not be dependent on any particular country. We can take the example of China here. China's share of imports into India in 2018, it stood at 14.5% according to an analysis by Confederation of Indian Industry. Particularly if you see areas such as active pharmaceutical ingredients for medicines like paracetamol, India is almost fully dependent on China. And also in the sphere of electronics, China accounts for 45% of India's imports. So when China was enforcing lockdowns in the months of February and March, India was much worried about shortage of active pharmaceutical ingredients because China is the principal supplier of these APIs for India. Now coming to Japan, Japan also faces a similar problem with heavy dependence on China for its imports and exports. See, though we are moving past the COVID-19 impact on supply chains, there is always worry of hostility with China, not just for India, but also for Japan. Now, it means if China intentionally blocks exports of critical nature, say for us, it could be active pharmaceutical ingredients, in such cases, both the nations, India and Japan, would suffer. And not just that, the rising tensions between US and China is also another factor that affects global economic ties and threatening the supply chains. So in order to effectively counter these developments, Japan has proposed Supply Chain Resilience Initiative as a trilateral approach to trade. So who are the other two partners? The other two partners proposed by Japan are India and Australia. Now, similar to India and Japan both being dependent on China, Australia is also highly dependent on China. Reports suggest that China is Australia's largest trading partner and it accounts for 32.6% of Australia's exports. That means almost one-third of exports from Australia go to China. During COVID-19, the antagonism between Australia and China was on the rise as Australia pushed for global inquiry on COVID-19. So in the context of these developments, Japan has now proposed this strategy with India and Australia as partners. As of now, this initiative is at the strategy stage or strategy planning stage, and it has some way to go before participants can realize trade benefits through the implementation of the initiative. Now we have to wait and see how India responds to this Supply Chain Resilience Initiative proposed by Japan. If India enhances self-reliance, or in other words, if India works with exporting nations other than China, it could bring resilience into the economy's supply networks. On August 13, 2020, we saw that such a foreign policy is called as self-reliant foreign policy, where diversification of cooperation is the essence of self-reliance. Internally, though we have done a lot to make India to appear as an attractive destination for investors, both as a market and also as a manufacturing base, there is even more to work upon, particularly in areas like ease of doing business and also in skill building. We definitely have to make considerable progress in these areas. And it is high time for India to reduce its dependence on China, particularly in the context of tensions between India and China. While we should diversify our sources at the international cooperation so as to attain self-reliance in foreign policy, we are also pushing to tap the inherent potential in our country through various campaigns like Atmanirbhar Bharat Mission, for which the Prime Minister's call is to be vocal about local, to make India self-reliant. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now let's take up this news article titled as CSIR to track employees' health for a period of 30 years. In this discussion, let's have a brief overview about CSIR and we'll discuss the news article in brief. CSIR stands for the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. It was set up in the year 1942 before independence as an autonomous body. At present, it is the largest publicly funded multidisciplinary industrial research and development organization in our country. It functions under the administrative supervision of Ministry of Science and Technology. It operates as an autonomous body and it is registered under the Societies Registration Act of 1860. Now, coming to the president and vice president of this CSIR, see, it is headed by Prime Minister as President and the Union Minister of Science and Technology as the Vice President. This council is known for cutting-edge R&D knowledge base in various science and technology areas. It has pan-India presence with dynamic network of 38 national laboratories, 39 outreach centers, 3 innovation complexes and 5 units. Now, today's news article states that the council is aiming to track health vitals of its 10,000 employees for a period of next 30 years. It is to build a medical cohort to give long-term perspective on the maladies that affect Indians and also to determine whether such a data bank can be used to help in predicting the onset of diseases. See, cohort studies are a type of longitudinal study, meaning the length of the research study will be more. For example, here it is 30 years. Such cohort studies are common in medical research and in psychology, which are used to investigate the causes of disease or psychological disorders and also to establish links between risk factors and health outcomes. Now, this program is reportedly optional and will also be done only with the consent of the employee. The news article also mentions 2 other such cohorts running in our country. One is Vadu Rural Health Program in Pune in Maharashtra, which is an initiative of KEM Hospital and its research center. It has been tracking a cohort of patients since 2002 and it is monitoring births, deaths, causes of death and migrations. Now, the other program is Garbhini in Gurugram of Haryana. Now, it's a pregnancy cohort to study multidimensional aspects of preterm birth in India. So, these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now, let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article talks about national sports awards, which were awarded by the President of India. It was given on August 29th, that is yesterday. Every year on August 29th, India celebrates National Sports Day to commemorate the birth anniversary of hockey wizard Dhyan Chand. In this context, let us have a brief understanding of the national sports awards. Coming to Dronacharya Awards, it was instituted in the year 1985. The awards are given to honor eminent coaches who have successfully trained sportspersons or teams so as to achieve outstanding results in international competitions. And then we have Arjuna Awards, which was instituted in 1961. The award is given to players who have exhibited good performance consistently for the previous 4 years at the international level and have shown qualities of leadership, sportsmanship and a sense of discipline. Now, coming to Dhyan Chand Awards for Lifetime Achievements in Sports and Games, this award was instituted in 2002. It is given to honor sportspersons who have contributed to sports by their performance and continue to contribute to the promotion of sports even after their retirement from sporting career. Now, coming to Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna Awards, it was instituted in 1991-92. It is given to sportspersons who have shown spectacular and outstanding performance over a period of 4 years immediately preceding the year during which the award is given. Now, the Rashtriya Khel Protsahan Puraskar, now it is given to recognize the contribution made to sports development by entities other than individual sportspersons and coaches. This award consists of a certificate and a trophy. Then we have Maulana Abul Kalam Azad Trophy. It was instituted in 1956-57. This trophy is awarded annually to the university that has given best all-round performance during the year of award. So these are some of the information with reference to the National Sports Awards. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. This news article states that Andhra Pradesh government is likely to release water from Krishna River to Chennai by September 14 or in the middle of September. In this context, it is important for us to know about River Krishna. In relation to this, we would like to inform viewers and aspirants that on 24th August 2020, we have discussed in detail about Krishna. And on 20th August 2020, we discussed in detail about River Godavari. And yesterday, August 29th, we discussed about River Maganadi. You may go through those classes for the knowledge related to these rivers. Now, let's move on to next part of the discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. See this question, consider the following: Iran, Iraq, Greece, Moldova, Caspian Sea, Mediterranean Sea. Which of the above regions border Turkey? See, of these, Moldova is a landlocked country and it does not share border with Turkey. If you know this fact, we can arrive at the correct answer, option B. Otherwise, we know that Greece borders with Turkey, but option A does not contain Greece. So you can eliminate option A in that way also. know that Turkey does not share border with Caspian Sea. The coastlines of Caspian Sea are shared by Azerbaijan, Iran, Kazakhstan, Russia, and Turkmenistan. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1, 2, 3, and 6. Now see this question, with which of the following countries India had trade surplus in financial year 2018-19? USA, United Arab Emirates, Indonesia, Germany. See, the correct answer for this question is option B, 1 and 2 only. This is as per the data available from Department of Commerce as presented in Economic Survey 2019-20. India had trade surplus with USA and United Arab Emirates in financial year 2019, that is 2018-19. So the correct answer is option B. Now this question is with reference to roll-on, roll-off service trains. Question reads, which of the following are benefits of the roll-on, roll-off service trains of Indian Railways recently seen in news? Avoids congestion on the roads, environment-friendly mode of transport, more turnaround time of road vehicles, linkage between agro-producing regions and agro-consumption centers. See, the correct answer should not contain third statement because turnaround time is reduced in case of roll-on, roll-off service trains. In case of trucks loaded on, roll-off service trains. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1, 2 and 4 only. Know that roll-on, roll-off service trains provides reduced turnaround time of trucks because the transport is faster compared to the travel of trucks through roads. Now this question is with reference to Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. Two statements are given. They are asking which of the statements are correct. It is a statutory body functioning under Ministry of Science and Technology. This statement is incorrect. Though it functions under the administrative supervision of Ministry of Science and Technology, it is not a statutory body. Rather, it is an autonomous body that is registered under Societies Registration Act of 1860. So the first statement is incorrect. The second statement, the President of India and the Union Minister of Science and Technology serve as President and Vice President of CSIR respectively. While the Union Minister of Science and Technology serves as Vice President, it is not the President of CSIR, it is the Prime Minister of India who is the President of CSIR. So the correct answer for this question is option D, neither one nor two. Now see this question, which is with reference to National Sports Awards of India. Two statements are given, they are asking which of the given statements are correct. First statement, Dronacharya Awards are given to players who exhibited good performance consistently for the previous 4 years at the international level. Now, this statement is incorrect. This award is referring to Arjuna Award. Remember that Dronacharya was a teacher in the Mahabharata epic. So as the name suggests, Dronacharya Awards are given to honor eminent coaches who have successfully trained sportspersons or teams so as to achieve outstanding results in international competitions. The second statement, Rashtriya Khel Protsahan Puraskar, is given to recognize the contribution of sportspersons and coaches to sports development. Now, this statement is also incorrect because this award is given to recognize the contribution made to sports development by entities other than sportspersons and coaches. For example, if you take the National Sports Awards 2020, this award is given to Army Sports Institute, Lakshya Institute, ONGC, Air Force Sports Control Board, and International Institute of Sports Management. So it is not given to individual sportspersons or coaches. Rather, it is given to entities. So the correct answer for this question is option D, neither one nor two. Now see this mains question in GS Paper 3. What are roll-on, roll-off service trains of Indian Railways? Explain how it can be helpful in ensuring speedy and efficient supply of essential commodities. So you have to first talk about roll-on, roll-off service trains. Then you have to explain how they are helpful through their advantages or benefits in ensuring speedy and efficient supply of essential commodities. You can relate it with in times of trouble, such as the one imposed by COVID-19 pandemic. You have to write within 150 words. You may write and post your answers in the comment section. Feedback for your answers will be given within a period of 1 week. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar AIS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.